Hello children, let me welcome you to the Virtual Training Center of the Brihan Mumbai Mahanagar Palika. My name is Shraddha teacher. Children, we are in the middle of the COVID-19 pandemic, isn't it? Because of that, we are not able to go to school. But that doesn't mean that we are going to stop learning. We are going to meet here regularly through the Virtual Training Center to learn many lessons in EVS. So come on, let's go to a lesson in EVS. So children, here I am back with a lesson in Standard 3rd, EVS, and we will be continuing the lesson that we were doing last time. So can you remember which lesson we were doing last time? Yes, it was lesson number 22, Who Fulfills Our Needs. So today children, we will be doing part 2 of this lesson. So let us quickly look at some pictures where we will revise what we learnt in the lesson last time. That is whatever we learned in the last video. We will quickly revise it in a matter of a few minutes and then we will go on and we will try and see some new points in this lesson. So it was a very, very interesting lesson last time where we talked about various occupations. Okay, and we discussed about all these people who help us in our day-to-day life. So there was the policeman, there was a nurse, postman, dentist, okay, we had the vet or the animal doctor, then we had the painter, builder, chef, there were firefighters who help us in case of a fire breaking out, then the barber who cuts our hair, pilots who fly planes, and then doctors who take care of us when we are sick. So we saw that these are all the different types of people who help us. They are our helpers, okay, and we also call them as people in different occupations. So painting is an occupation, building is an occupation, a person who is a pilot, he has got that particular occupation, okay. So we also saw that occupations could be of different types, all right. We can have different types of occupations as well. So which are the different types of occupations? We saw there are four major types of occupations. The first one is based on nature. So based on nature, we have occupations like farming, fishing, etc. Then we saw the second kind of occupation, which was based on manufacture or making something, manufacturing. And there we saw that we have occupations like making cars, making buses, making cloth, etc. The third kind of occupation that we discussed was, children, it was about a trade. Trade means what? Buying and selling. So we had people who sell so many things. Now this is a simple vegetable seller, but then he is also a trader. Okay? And the last kind of occupation is where we give service to people. Okay, and in that occupation, we have people like doctors, we have people like teachers, okay, lawyers, etc., who are all part of the service occupation. So this is all that we learned last time, children. Now we will start once again by discussing the importance of farming or agriculture as an important occupation. Agriculture is one of the occupations based on nature. Agriculture, we also call it as farming, okay, and let us see the importance of agriculture or farming now. So yesterday we discussed that farming is called as a primary occupation. Why? Because there are so many other occupations which are dependent on farming. All right, only if farmers will farm, only as farmers will grow crops, there will be so many other people also who will be able to do their own work. So farming or agriculture is the basic and the most important occupation. One reason is that many other occupations are dependent on it. One more reason and very important reason is food is a basic need. None of us will be able to survive if there is no food to eat on our plates. And who are the people who bring this food to our plates? It is these hard-working farmers. Okay, so farming is a very, very important occupation. and you will see that farmers grow not only rice and wheat and grains, but they also grow a number of vegetables, fruits, etc. Even people who take care of animals are called as farmers. Okay, so this is all the agricultural produce that you can see. So there are vegetables, there are fruits, there are grains, okay, and there are different kind of roots, there are different kind of dry fruits. So these are all the things that we earn or we get as a result of farming, and this fulfills our basic need, that is the need for food. So that is why farming is a very, very important occupation. There are some other people also who are dependent on farming. For example, people who pluck fruits, people who make oil from the various oil seeds. Even animals are dependent on farming, children. Why? Because you can see the cow, you can see the sheep eating grass, eating hay, which we get from the farms. Okay, so that is why farming is a very, very important occupation. And there are many other industries which are dependent on farming. For an example, we will take the jam making industry. So all of us, we apply jam and butter to bread and we eat it for breakfast. So this jam, it comes from the fruits. Okay, so the place where this jam is made, the factory where this jam is made, will not be there if there are no fruit gardens or orchards, as we call them. And who are the people who manage these fruit gardens? They are the fruit farmers. Okay, so because of fruit farming, there is this jam making industry. So jam making industry depends on the fruit farmers. Alright, so in the same way, there are many other industries also which are dependent on agriculture. For example, see, we have all these industries. The industry which produces jaggery. Now recently, a few days ago, we had the festival of Holi, where your mother must have prepared Puran Poli, isn't it? When she makes Puran Poli, what does she add to the chana dal? Yes, she adds jaggery to make it sweet. Okay, so this jaggery you get from the sugar cane. The sugar cane the farmer grows on his field. So see, that is an agro industry. And then about jam we already talked about. Then you have wine which we get from grapes. You have various kind of juices, pineapple juice, orange juice, apple juice. All these we get from the fruit farmers. Okay, all these fruits for making the juice we get from fruit farmers. Then you have various kind of oil also there. You have groundnut oil, coconut oil, you have sesame oil, til ka tel we call it. You have mustard oil. All this, the sesame, the mustard, the groundnut, is grown by farmers. Okay, so these are all agro industries. So now you know how farming and why farming is the most important or the basic or the primary occupation. There are many animals also which are raised by these farmers. So farmers not only grow crops, they not only grow plants, but they also raise a variety of animals. For example, see the cow, the goat, the sheep, the pig, the horse. All these animals have their own uses. The cow gives us milk. The sheep and the goat and the pig, they give us milk as well as flesh. Okay, the horse is used by people for various services. So people who take care of these kind of animals also, they are also called as farmers. Okay, so see, that is why I said that farming is the most important of all activities. Growing crops is the most important of all activities. See, and see how these animals also are dependent on farming. Animals are also dependent on agriculture. We have these kind of grass which is grown, and this grass becomes fodder for these animals. So unless and until the farmer grows that grass, the cows and the buffaloes and the oxes, they will not be able to eat. They will have to go hungry. Okay, so this is very, very important as far as farming is concerned. Look at these animals. What are they eating? There is a hen and a cock here. What are they eating? They're eating grains. And the grains are also, in a way, grown on farms. Okay, so whichever kind of industry you pick up, somewhere or the other, it is all related to agriculture or to farming. See, what are they eating? They're eating maize, okay, makka. See how happily they're feasting on it. Alright, so all this also comes from the farm. Now let us go back. When we talk about farming, now we know that people do farming on big, huge fields, and they use different kind of modern methods like tractors and machines, etc. today. But in the beginning, when civilization began, when man started existing, there were no farms, there were no cities, there was no development. Why? Because ancient humans, we were nomads. Now, what is the meaning of a nomad? Who is a nomad? A nomad is a person who does not have a fixed place to live in. Okay? He keeps wandering from one place to another along with his family and along with his animals. So these nomads, see, you can see he has a dog and he has certain sheep, okay, a few horses, mules, donkeys, etc. So these people used to go from one place to another. And what was their major occupation? Not at all farming. Farming was not an occupation at all. Then what they used to do for a living? They used to hunt animals, okay? They used to climb on the trees and they used to break the berries and the fruits, etc. from the trees, and they used to eat. So now what happened was, once in a particular place, the fruits, etc. got over, they used to pack their things and they used to move to another place. They did not know the meaning of settling down, okay? Their life was very, very, you can say, backward. See, they did not know how to wear clothes, alright? And they used to live a very, very primitive life. The life of a person who doesn't know anything, who is not at all modern. Not like us today, okay? Then how was this possible? How did this modern world come into being? I told you, agriculture, farming is very important. So see, this is one more importance of farming. Slowly, what people started doing is, they started living near the places where there was water. Okay? For example, near a lake, near a river, they started staying. Why did they start staying in such places? Because water is a basic need. You need water for everything, isn't it? For drinking, for keeping yourself clean, for your animals. Slowly, slowly they started building small houses, and they started living close to places where there is water. Then one person built a house, then another person built a house, and then another person built a house, and slowly these small colonies started developing. And then people started doing a little bit of farming also. They thought that now we have built a house, so we are going to stay here. So come on, let us try to grow some plants for our own need. And that is how, children, slowly and slowly farming or agriculture started. Okay? So then once people started farming, once they came to know that it is very good, we can produce this grain, and we can keep the extra grain also, so that our children will not go hungry tomorrow. Tomorrow, if I don't find anything to eat, my children will be hungry. But if I produce this grain and if I store it for my children, then tomorrow my children will not be hungry. So they realized this, and then slowly and slowly farming became an important occupation. And then they started making some pakka houses or some pakka colonies. Alright, here you can see the houses were not permanent houses. They were just small huts. Slowly they developed and they started making small but good colonies near their farms. So you look at this colony here, and if you look far away, you will also see a lot of fields surrounding the houses. So this is how agriculture became a very, very important occupation for the people in the ancient times. And it is because of this agriculture that they started settling down in a place. And then they started developing the place also. See here, slowly and slowly the villages became a little bigger, and then they became a little bit more bigger, and then today they are big cities. Slowly, slowly, now man did not have to go hunting every day, so he had a little bit of time for himself. So he started thinking about other things also. Okay, he began to have more free time, so he started making some discoveries. For example, see, man discovered the wheel. Man invented the use of the wheel, which made his life very easy. All right, man invented electricity, which made his life easier. So on, slowly and slowly, we will see how industries started developing. Because of the discoveries that we made, because of the free time that we had, because we did not have to hunt for food anymore every day, we started developing slowly and slowly, and see where we are today. We have these modern industries, okay? These beautiful big industries where so many things are manufactured, and our life has become much easier as compared to the life of ancient man. And where does all this start, children? All this started when we settled down and we learned how to grow crops and how to get food in one particular place only. So if you open your textbook, you have this beautiful box on page number 128, which tells you about the story of agriculture, which I have just showed you. Okay, so this is how human beings developed. Now let us come to the next kind of occupation. We call it as industry, where we manufacture so many things. So we will start with a very basic industry, or a very, you can say, small scale industry, something which can be done at home also without too many machineries. And that industry is the pot making or clay making type of industry. Okay, you use clay, you use mud in order to make pots. This is also a manufacturing industry. Okay, so let us see how it goes. Now this is again a picture from your textbook. So let us try and understand this picture. So in the beginning, the potter finds and obtains good quality clay. Now he will need clay to make the pots. All right. So he will find good quality clay. Now what will he do? If he uses only clay, maybe the pots will not be strong enough. So to improve the quality of the pots, he mixes some other substances into the clay to make the pot harder, to make the pot last longer. Okay, after he does that, then he starts to mix water in the clay, and he kneads the clay. Now you must have seen your mother doing a similar thing at home when she makes roti or when she makes chapatis out of flour. She takes the dry flour in a bowl, she adds water, and she kneads it. She makes it soft. This is called as kneading. Okay. After kneading, what he does is, he takes the clay on a wheel and he shapes it into a pot. So now the clay has mixed with some other substances. It has mixed with water. It has become soft and it has got a particular shape also. After that, it is baked in these bhattis or these ovens, which you call as kerns. Okay, so it is then baked properly, and then you have the finished product, that is a ready pot. So that is why it is called as the manufacturing industry. Why? Because what is the raw material? The raw material is the clay, raw. It is unfinished, unprocessed raw material. After a lot of process happens, all the process we saw here, isn't it? What does he do? He brings it, he mixes it, he kneads it, he shapes it, he bakes it. So after all this processing happens, then we have the pot, which is the finished product. Okay, so this is why it is called as an industry. Why? Because there are so many processes in it. Isn't it? So that is why it is called as the industry. So just like the potter makes pots, there are certain other small industries also which you will see around you. For example, see those aunties, what are they making? They're making agarbatti, or they're making incense sticks. You use incense sticks when you do puja. Okay, so incense sticks. Then you can see some people making some kind of oil. Then someone is making belan there for making chapatis. Okay, and of course pots and pans. So if these kind of things are made at home only with small machines, then they are called as a cottage industry, or they are called as a handicraft industry. Okay, and then you have some factories which are very big. See, huge factories. There are so many people who might be working here, and there are huge machines also which are used. Okay, so these are not cottage industry, these are not small scale industry, they are large scale industries. So now we have a small activity on map reading also in our textbook. Now since I am using an EVS textbook for Brihan Mumbai, you will see the map of Brihan Mumbai here on the screen. Now you might belong to a different district, children, since this video is being made not only for Mumbai district but for the children all over Maharashtra. So you might be having a different map on your book depending on the district to which you belong. But we are going to look at just some basic things over here, okay? So you will look at the map here now. Let's take a look at this map. And now you will pay attention to my arrow also, which is moving on the screen. So let us look at the name of the map, children, first. Let us take the name of the map. Let me use a pen to show you. So see, this is a map of Brihan Mumbai. Okay? This is a map of Brihan Mumbai. What does it show? It shows major industries in Brihan Mumbai. So that is the most important thing for us to see, what the map is showing you. Different maps might show you different things. So this is a map of Mumbai where we can see the major industries in Mumbai. Now there are two parts to this Mumbai. One is the Mumbai suburban district and the other one is the Mumbai city district. Okay, so in the city district you have places like Sion, Dadar, Prabhadevi, Sivri. You have Mumbai Central, Baikala, Fort, Churchgate, Kulaba, etc. In the suburban district you can see Dahisar, Borivali, Kandivali, Malad, Goregaon, Chakala, etc. You will also be able to see some neighboring districts. Okay, here you will be able to see Thane district. Okay, this is Thane district here. See this place. Here you can see Navi Mumbai, and here you can see Raigad. Now Raigad is far off. It is separated by this water. Alright, now let us focus on the directions which are given. See, this indicates the northern direction, the southern direction, western and eastern direction. So when you pick up any map, these are the things you should first notice. Alright, then you can see the Arabian Sea here. So it will give you a lot of knowledge about the place that you are going to talk about, or the map that you are going to learn about. Now let us come to the main point, that is we are going to consider the industries in Mumbai. So they have highlighted two industries. See, one is the soaps and perfumes and oil industry. Other one is the medicine factory. Let us now look at which are the industries, or where are the places where there are soaps and perfumed oils or medicines here. So one place, and look at the symbol also, children. For soap and perfumed oil you have this five-sided figure. Okay, and for these medicine factories you have this dark circle. Alright, a grey circle. So come on, now let us check out where we have the soaps and perfume industry. So see here, can you see the mark over here? So in Vikhroli you have the soap and perfume oil factory, that is we have the Godrej factory at Vikhroli. Okay, then in this place called Chakala, pay attention to the symbol, search for the symbol. You're supposed to search for medicine factory now. So there it is, in Chakala you have a factory which produces medicines. Okay, so this is how you read the map. Alright, so this is a small you can say activity where we have tried to read the map. Now there are some more activities, children. Now that also will depend on which district you belong to. So I will leave that activity to you as assignment, where you are supposed to find out which are the industries in your area, that is in the district where you live, which are the various industries, and try to find out on the map where are the places where those industries will be found. Okay, so this was a small exercise on map reading also. Now let us go to another exercise over here and let us try to fill in this table. So use the table below to see how the raw material, industry and finished products are linked. So here you can see on one end you have the raw material, on the other end you have the finished product. And the industry is the place where the manufacturing is done or the processing is done. Okay, so we are going to take a look at a cycle of some things or some goods, where we will see which the raw material is and which the name of the industry is and what is a finished product also. So the first one is sugarcane. So you must have all seen sugarcane, isn't it? Sugarcane looks like this. What is the name of the industry? Sugar industry. With sugarcane you can make many other things also, but let us look at one type of example today so that confusion is avoided. So you have sugarcane, which is a raw material. It is bought from the fields. It is taken to the sugar industry and it is processed. And what is the finished product that you get? It is sugar. All right. The next example they given us is cloth. Cloth is kapda. Okay. What is the industry there? It is the garment industry. Okay. And what is the finished product? You have clothes. For example, you have shirts, you have jeans, you have frock. Then you come to the next industry, which is the bamboo. Bamboo is a raw material. You take it to an industry which is called as the basket weaving industry, and then you end up getting baskets. Okay, then the next one is maida. Maida is a raw material which is again made from wheat. Okay, so that is another process, but now we are taking maida as a raw material. What is the name of the industry? It is the bakery industry. And then what do you get? You get biscuits, you get bread, you get cake, etc. So you see how the raw material is taken to the industry and how you get the finished product in your hand. So let me give you a small assignment here again. Try to find out at least three more raw materials and see and look up the industry in which these raw materials are processed, and then try to tell me what are the finished products. Okay, so this is a small assignment for you for now. Let us move on and then let us do one more exercise which is there in the textbook, which is very, very interesting also. So you may have seen or used the products shown in the picture. Write the name of these products in the boxes which are given below. So now here at this point of time, I will want you to pause the video and write the name of the products, because I'm sure you know the name of all these products. Okay, then we will go to the next part of the exercise. So have you written down the names? Let us check. Yes, so this is wheat. These are fruits. This is a garland which is made with flowers. This is a nice red smart car. And then you have buns and bread. Then you have pickle. And I think you have papad also there. I'm not sure whether it is papad, but you can say pickle is there definitely. So I've written pickle. You have a tire which you use for your car, for your bikes, even for your bicycles. And then finally you have sugar. Okay, so these are the names of the products. Now let us see what they are asking us in the next part of the exercise. Which of these products in the pictures are grown in the fields? What do you think? Which of them are grown in the fields? So yes, we have wheat which is grown in the fields, we have fruits which are grown on the fields, and flowers which make up this garland are grown in the fields. All right, The next one, let us see what is the next question they're asking us. Which of these products can be made at home? So yes, I can make bread at home. I can make cake at home. I can even make pickles at home. I can also make the garland at home. Okay, in the previous picture, we had seen the garland. Even that I will be able to make at home. All right. Then let's see the next question. Which products are made in the factories? So what do you think? Which of these products can you make in the factory? Can you make the pickle at home? Yes, you can. But can you make a tire at home? Of course not. So let's see which products are made in the factory. The car is made in the factory. We cannot make a car at home. The tires are manufactured in the factory. You cannot make tires at home. And finally, you have sugar, which is made in the factory or manufactured in the factory. So now you understand which all things can come under small scale and which of the things can come under large scale. Also, you can know now which of the things are agro-based and which are the things which are agro-based, but later on they go into the manufacturing processes. Okay, so this was about this lesson, children, but we are not over yet. We have certain very interesting pieces of information again from your textbook. So let us look at that information along with these beautiful pictures. So there are certain places which are famous for certain things in Maharashtra. For example, these are bed sheets which are very, very famous in Solapur. So if you go to Solapur, you will be able to see people who go as tourists. When they come back, they definitely purchase a few of them. So these cotton bed sheets, you will see that they are a speciality of that particular place. Okay, like when you talk about the entire Maharashtra, you will see that the vada pav is a thing which was invented here in Maharashtra. So wherever you go in Maharashtra, you will be able to see people eating vada pav. So the same way, when you talk about industry, bed sheets are very, very famous in Solapur. So whenever you go to Solapur, you will be able to see a lot of shops where they sell these bed sheets exclusively. All right. So this is a special thing which is sold in a special place. Okay. For example, if you go to Paithan. Now see, Paithan is this place in Maharashtra. If you go to Paithan, you will see the saris from Paithan are very, very famous. So in case you happen to go to Paithan, you might surely visit a place where they manufacture these saris. Alright, so you can see how Paithan as a place is famous for manufacturing saris. Then, if you have ever been to Kolhapur, apart from the Mahalakshmi temple which is famous there, these Kolhapuri chappals are extremely popular. So whoever goes to Kolhapur buys a pair of Kolhapuri chappals for himself. So these are some places where, or some villages or some towns or some cities where certain occupations or certain industries are available on a large scale. There are so many people who are doing the same thing. Manufacturing Paithani saris, manufacturing Kolhapuri chappals, etc. So now there is one more assignment coming your way. So try to find out about such industries or occupation in your district or in your area. Okay, so here we will wind up this particular lesson about who fulfills our needs. But before we go, let us discuss a very, very important and crucial point with which this lesson will end. So let us always remember that man has developed many occupations. However, the materials that he needs for these occupations are obtained from nature. So what is most important? It is nature. It is our surrounding, our environment, our Mother Earth, which is most important. If we are running behind all the goods that we are getting, but we are not taking care of our environment, of our surrounding, then what will happen is very soon we will not be able to live. Nature takes care of all the needs of all living beings. That is why we should respect nature. Okay, so on this note, let us quickly revise whatever we have learned. We have learned about occupations and industries which have developed slowly because of the various needs that we human beings have. We also talked about the types of occupations and types of industry. We discussed why agriculture is a very, very important occupation. We also understood what the meaning of industry is. And we talked about industries which are existent in our district, Mumbai, as well as certain places which are famous for certain things. So that was all in this lesson number 22, Who Fulfills Our Needs. Hope you enjoyed the lesson. Hope you learned a lot of new things. And also hope you will respect and value nature after learning now that whatever we get from nature. So on that note, let me say thank you to you all and have a good day too. So children, wasn't that a very interesting lesson? I'm sure you learned a lot of new things in this lesson. If you have liked this video, please hit the like button and also subscribe to my video so that you will get to see all the videos which I keep posting regularly.